Broadcasting live statewide from the Civic Media Studios in Green Bay, this is Nightlight with Pete Schwabba, your inside source on everything entertainment from Wisconsin to Hollywood. And now, a guy who wanted to be in porn but didn't have the acting chops, Pete Schwabba.
Welcome back to hour number two of Nightlight, where we talk show business and entertainment and all the things that make us feel downright groovy. Great to have you with me on a Thursday night. I got a couple more texts regarding our question of the night, which is, what sitcom would you want to live in if you could? If you could crawl into a sitcom world and live there, what sitcom would it be? Got some great texts so far. A friend of mine texted me and said he would not want to live in MASH. My Clemens made reference to the sitcom MASH when he was talking about Joe Barry. A war-torn sitcom would not be good. And Conrad's mom actually said that Conrad's dad fell asleep, but he said Seinfeld. So we have to credit anyone. Conrad's family is always, they're great texters. Texting is in their genes. Coming up at the bottom of the hour, Heather Heil, a local gal made good here in Green Bay. She'll join me in just a little while. Right now, we are going to turn our attention to theater and live theater, which you cannot beat the excitement of live theater. And if you haven't seen a big show, like a big Broadway show somewhere in Wisconsin or anywhere for that matter, you really should, because there is nothing like that live theater performance. And joining us now to talk about this is the Chief Artistic Experiences Officer at the Overtune Center in Madison, Tim Sauers. Hi, Tim.
Hi, how are you?
Doing very well, thank you. Thanks for being with us tonight.
Yeah, thanks for having me tonight.
So I have to be honest, you are the first, I've never heard of this title before.
I know, right?
The cool. Chief Artistic Experiences Officer. You're our first, so, and you're obviously a busy guy. I've been trying to have you on the show for a while. So I'm guessing with that title comes a lot of responsibility. Tell us a little bit about what you do for the Overtune Center.
Yeah, for the Overtune Center, one of my main responsibilities is I oversee all of the programming that comes in and out of the building. So, like, you know, our touring Broadway, the comedians that come in, the dance, the concerts. And I also sit with five of my colleagues, and we run the organization as a team. We're doing a shared leadership model. So artistic experiences came about because there was a time period where I was overseeing all of the programming and all of the marketing. And wow. And what we like to have is, you know, when everybody comes into the building, whether they're going to one of our shows or the resident companies that perform in our building or in our galleries, we want to make sure that they all had amazing artistic experience. So that was kind of cool. And so we kind of kept it and play with it because, you know, at Overtune, we want our guests when they come into the building to have an amazing time, right?
Yeah. So let me ask you, I used to do stand-up comedy. I used to work Madison twice a year when they had a comedy club that was just a few doors down from the Capitol on State Street, not the one that's there now. But did the Overtune Center used to be part of, there's kind of that brick entrance down the street, and it has like a A-frame type dealio. Was that part of the right. Overtune Center at one point, or were they joined, or are they still?
That arch frame is now in the kind of the outside of our building. It's kind of one of the entrances that come into the Overtune okay. Center. And, you know, next year we're going to be celebrating our 20th anniversary. And the way that the building began was it was the Madison Civic Center. And
yeah,
the old Capitol,
right.
the old okay. Capitol Theater was over 2,000 seats.
Right.
And so they renovated that old theater down to 1,000 seats. And then they built that whole center around that historic theater.
No kidding. So okay.
It's pretty amazing. I mean, you know, I was living in Chicago, and I came up to interview almost 16 years ago, originally for the director of education. And, you know, and I was like living in Chicago, and I said, yeah, I'll come up for an interview. But I said, I don't know if I'm interested in moving to Madison, Wisconsin. Right. And I walked in this amazing building and fell in love with it. And I got the job, and that's 16 years later.
That's pretty cool. Right. Yeah. And I'm kind of in the same boat. I was when I started doing stand-up, it was out of Chicago. I didn't have much familiarity with Madison. So when I started going there to do stand-up, I'm like, how did I not know much about Madison, Wisconsin? I absolutely love this town. It was a great comedy town. It's a great town because it's not huge, but it feels big because there's really cool stuff to do there.
Yeah. You know? I mean, in the 16 years that I've lived here, the town has grown immensely, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, we're now a foodie town.
Right.
And all the venues that have opened up, like with the Sylvie, with all the stand-up, the concerts coming through town. I mean, really everything is coming through our town and our state, right?
Yeah.
Like there's so many great venues throughout the entire state, and it's great because we can all route shows together and makes it viable for the artists to come to Wisconsin, right?
That's one of the questions I was going to ask you, Tim. I saw Les Mis maybe 5 years ago.
And yeah.
I've seen it about five times in various cities,
yeah.
But I saw it. I took my kids to Appleton, the PAC.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
That's Fox the same cities, show yeah. that comes through your
correct
place,
yeah,
the Overtune.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, that is right. Nice. Okay. So,
I mean, how great for all these communities, you know, if you want to talk a little bit about Broadway, there's, you know, the three major Broadway houses are the Marcus Center in Milwaukee, Fox City's up in Appleton, and then the Overtune Center.
Right.
And then there's all the other venues like the Grand in Wausau and the Widener Center in Green Bay, and they all get Broadway. I mean, Broadway's a big business right now. Right.
It sure is. Do you find, here's where I was going with this. Les Mis is like my favorite show ever, live show.
Yeah.
And there's not much drop off, is there? Like, I know that the theaters you could see it in New York and Chicago might be a little bit bigger, but in terms of the talent, you know, you could see someone in Madison or Appleton that ends up on Broadway a year later. The talent, I was amazed that there was like no drop off in talent.
Mm-mm. Or the talent has already been on Broadway and they're
right.
in a touring show on the road, right? Like,
definitely.
You know, it's a viable place for performers to be, you know, getting high visibility and high caliber work too, right?
Yeah, definitely. What, okay, so let's talk a little bit about what's coming up. That Tina Turner show looks really kind of cool.
It's a great show. That's when is that?
I have your website.
I don't, you know,
it's coming
it's
up.
Funny because I'm working way into past next season into 25-26 already. Right. So I never know when the show comes to town because we have Les Mis coming in starting February 14th for the weekend.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, we didn't have it yet. Right.
So does that work with Les Mis? Like, because I was amazed at how, you know, the background, at least up here in Appleton a few years ago, was kind of virtual almost at times. Is that kind of what you guys do? Is that how they're able to have such quick turnover with these shows?
What do you mean? Say that again to me.
Well, okay. So when I saw Les Mis in Appleton here a few years ago, they had kind of a backdrop where they could change the scenery.
Oh, yeah. Video is really big now.
Is that why you can turn shows over?
Technology is really big in the show. Because, you know, if you go back to the old show of Les Miserables, when it came out in the 80s, they were known for their staging with the big turntable.
Yeah.
Had this whole
incredible.
Epic. But now in the modern world, they can really do the same thing with technology. And it's used almost in every show now. There's some form of technology or video and it makes it I would say in the design of it can be more flexible for them,
right?
And it can also be cheaper. Like, you know, these shows travel in trucks.
Yeah,
you know, you like a Lion King comes with like 16 trucks when they're unloading.
Jeez.
And a Les Mis, I don't know how many trucks Les Mis has, but you know, that show has so many costumes and wigs. It's crazy. But technology with it. And you know, it's all these state-of-the-art venues are able to get the show in for with it, too.
Yeah, definitely. So you got Les Mis the 14th, that Tina Turner musical I'm looking at here is June 11th. I imagine that's something you'll be singing in your head for weeks afterwards.
Yeah, it's a great bio musical. It really, really highlights her life and tells her kind of backstory. And it's lovely. Like, her grandmother was a big influence in her life. And there's scenes with her as a little girl with her grandmother. And then, you know, just what it was of a woman coming up in that rock era and how strong she was as a character, as a person, right? And the music is, you know, unforgettable.
How long does it take? So I'm kind of fascinated. You said 16 trucks. In Les Mis, is there a week? That almost seems like more trouble than it's worth. I mean, I'm sure they sell out.
They'll come in on a Monday, and they load in on the Monday. And then on the Tuesday, they tech it all. And then the cast comes in and has their rehearsal. And then Tuesday night, the show goes up, plays 8 performances, and they load out on Sunday night after the last show.
That is insane.
And they move on to their next site. So they're really somewhere different every week.
Wow. Do you have a favorite show, Tim?
Oh, my gosh. There's just, I mean, so I'd say Les Mis is one up there for me.
Yeah.
It's just a powerful, beautiful show. I'm a fan of Wicked, you know, everybody loves Wicked, and that show just celebrated 20 years on Broadway.
It's a fun one too. Yeah.
I mean, crazy.
So Tim, tonight I'm going to run my question by you. You can give it a minute to think about if you want, cause I want to ask you about, I know you're into live, obviously that's your world is live entertainment, but on this show, we typically talk about what we're watching, TV, films, and Oscar nominations and all that kind of stuff. So I don't know if you have anything you could recommend, but if you can hang out just for a couple more minutes, I'll ask you.
Oh, yeah,
you that
I have.
Too.
I'm a big movie guy. I like my movies, and I watch a lot of TV.
Okay.
I watch a lot of stuff.
I love it. So we'll talk to you about that. But right now, what sitcom do you want to live in? Tim, where would you go?
I think I want to live in Ted Lasso.
Oh, nice. I haven't heard that one yet.
Love that show, and it's a warm, fuzzy world.
Yes, it sure is. And real quick before we move on to TV stuff, what you just said, Madison's a foodie town too. You have access to so many great restaurants. What's your place of choice just off State Street? Or in Madison in general?
State Street, like just off State Street. Cooper's Tavern is really great for like kind of a bar hangout location.
Yeah.
I love, my favorite Chinese is called Hong Kong Cafe.
Yep.
I just discovered it. Amazing. The Harvey House is a really great new kind of, well, it's not new anymore. I forget about COVID, right?
All right. I could see Tim is having as much trouble honing in on one restaurant as he is as one musical. All right. Hold that thought. We'll be right back with more with Tim Sauers on Nightlight with Peach Wabba here on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Often wonder what makes her work. I guess I'll leave that question to the experts. Assuming that there are some out there, they're probably alone. Solitaire. I can remember when I caught up with a pastime intimate friend. She said, but you're probably gonna say I look lovely, but you probably don't think nothing of me. She was right though.
Tomorrow night on Nightlight, Rob Thomas, the fantastic entertainment reporter from the Capital Times, joins me to talk Oscars. Right now, on the phone is the, or on the online, I should say, is the Chief Artistic Experiences Officer at the Overtune Center, Tim Sauers. We're talking live shows. And Tim, I have one more question for you before we move on to what you're watching regarding movies and TV. But so what I love about live theater is also a concern that it is expensive. It's almost like professional sporting events. Not everyone has the means to see such fantastic shows or attend one at a big venue. Do you guys ever offer like discounted tickets or tickets for less fortunate?
Absolutely. And we always try to price the houses so that we do have affordable tickets.
How do people find out more about that?
Just by going on our website at overture.org and look into the show. And a lot of the shows also do a lottery each night, where they offer discounted tickets, like a $20 or a $25 ticket. And you know, I don't know how all of them work. Some are very different. Everybody used to have to come and stand in line, but now I think you can just put your name in on an app.
Okay. that's nice.
Yeah,
especially
nice,
in cold
right?
Wisconsin. I know, because I live in a rural area where, you know, not everybody, I see that once kids are exposed to live performing, and we have a great children's theater and a great community theater where I live, they love it, but it's not always available to them. And I think if they go to places like the Overtune Center or Milwaukee or Appleton here and have that experience, it can be life-changing, you know? So good for you guys. That's great.
It was for me.
Yeah.
You know, I was a kid. I went to something. I went to a high school musical that my brother was in the pit band, right, in the orchestra. Oh, and I just fell in love with it.
What was the show?
Bye Bye Birdie.
Nice. And then were you a performer too?
Well, when I was in second grade, I was a shy, introverted kid growing up in rural Pennsylvania on a farm. And my teacher did a play of Mr. Popper's Penguins. And I was in second grade and I was in the lead. And I came home from it and I told my parents I was going to be an actor. And I was. I did acting and directing. Nice. And I ran an improv company for years in Chicago. And it was all fun. It led me all to where I am today.
Oh, we probably have a lot of friends in common, so we'll have to talk one of these days. But
yeah, really.
What are you watching, Tim? Like, what kind of movies and TV do you watch, and what can you recommend to listeners?
I just finished Fargo, the new season of Fargo.
I'm three episodes in, and I don't ever want it to end.
It's
so
the
good.
Best since the first one. That Juno Temple is a fireball in it.
Speaking of Ted Lasso,
I just finished The Gilded Age on Max. I think that's a really fun, frothy little period piece. And there's tons and tons of Broadway people in it.
Okay.
I just finished Beef on Netflix. I loved that. It's about a road rage that goes wrong. It just won a whole bunch of Emmys and Golden Globes over the last couple of weeks. And so there's lots of good things. We can't say there's not much to watch.
No, that's for sure. That's on my list too. I've heard Beef is great. And The Gilded Age.
Yeah,
for that matter.
It's really good.
There's almost too much content. It's like, I get the stuff and it's like, oh, this was released 4 years ago. I'm just getting to it. And I have people that watch even more TV than me and they haven't seen stuff. And it's almost overwhelming, but it is great that we have it. Have you seen any of the Oscar nominees?
Yeah, quite a few of them. I loved, course, you know, big ones in the summer, the Oppenheimer.
Sure.
The Oppenheimer-Barbie combo, right?
Like, Barbenheimer,
that was amazing on what it did. What Barbie did for Oppenheimer to make it this huge success.
Right.
I loved The Holdovers. I loved Anatomy of a Fall. I just saw American Fiction.
I haven't seen that yet. That was good, huh?
It was good. It's a great story. It's great storytelling. Killer of the Flower Moon. I mean, there's just so much diversity in all of the. The movie I was most disappointed in, though, is I loved a movie called Saltburn.
Oh, I saw Saltburn, sure.
And it didn't get any Oscar nominations. I was sad.
I was, I will say, Tim, I went into Saltburn not knowing anything about it.
Me too.
And it just held, I will say it held my interest. I thought it got a little crazy, but I thought it was pretty cool. And I loved the kind of the aesthetics of it and the cast was great. And it did hold my interest. I will say that, but a couple times I was like, okay. And I couldn't tell if it was like, it seemed like some of the things he did were pretty strange, but they came out of the character. So I can deal with that. But it did get a little crazy at the end, but I liked it. I'm not surprised it wasn't nominated either, though, if that makes sense.
I thought she would be, though. What's her name?
Roseman Pike.
Yeah, she was nominated for a lot of the other stuff. I liked it because nothing was predictable for me.
Well, that's for sure.
And I was like, in the end, when they, you know, I won't say anymore. People want to see it.
Yeah, right. Don't give it away. Make them sit through it. That's what I say. So, and I thought also Anatomy of a Fall. I got to say, it's not like I didn't like it. I liked it, but I thought it was a little long. And I just, I didn't think it was great. But people are losing their minds over this movie.
Yeah, there are those. I thought this year, too, there was a lot of small movies.
Yeah.
And you know, they were good movies, but were they great movies?
Right.
That's why a movie like Oppenheimer really stands out for me, because I thought that was just a incredible feat being made. Did you see Poor Things?
Not yet. I have three movies to see before the Oscars, and that's one of them. That one in a
I have Poor Things, The Zone of Interest, and past lives, and then I'll see all the best pictures.
Those are my three too. Well, actually, yeah, those are my three too. Past lives, American fiction, zone of interest.
I try to see them all, but I never do.
Well, I think you're doing pretty well, especially with how busy you are with your day job, Tim. So keep up the great work. And yeah, it was great. Thanks for taking time out tonight. I appreciate it.
Yeah,
Let's do it again.
Having me. I really appreciate it too.
Anytime.
I'd love to talk with you anytime.
All right. I'll keep that in mind. Thanks and continued success with the Overture.
Thank you so much.
All right, buddy. Have a great night. That is Tim Sauers. He is the, I have to go to my paper again to read his title. He's the Chief Artistic Experiences Officer at the Overtune Center. So check out, they have so many great shows coming up. The Tina Turner Show, Les Mis, Beetlejuice. If you haven't taken your kids to a live Broadway class show, you can see them right here in Wisconsin, in Madison, Milwaukee, and Appleton, and here in Green Bay too. I think we're on a different circuit here, but the Widener Center, the Resch Center, it's some really great, but definitely take in some Broadway, that you can find here, right here in Wisconsin. It's nice that we have access to that. So Conrad, you said, you know, we've got pretty good answers tonight with our question.
Yeah.
What sitcom would you want to live in? And I thought, I just realized I never really answered it. I would say Seinfeld because I agree with your dad. I want to be Kramer's neighbor. So what about you, buddy?
Well, I can't. Okay. So I have two answers because I just can't decide between the two. Okay. And it's Friends or How I Met Your Mother.
Okay. Oh, those are both good. All right. Well, you got time to think about it. We'll figure it out. And you know what? Also, it's a National Opposite Day. I really feel like we kind of missed the boat there. We could have had a lot of fun.
This is not Nightlight with Peach Wabba.
Well, it's alternative Peach Wabba because I'm not myself tonight. So something's amiss. But in just a minute, we're going to be back with Miss Green Bay, Heather Heil. She joins me here in studio on Nightlight with Peach Wabba on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Can't get no rest. Don't know how I work all day. When will I learn? Memories get in the way. I walk around. I can't hear a sound. Folks talking loud, but I don't see at all. I gotta get away, gotta get away. I don't
know where to go. It's hopeless.
Welcome back to Nightlight. In tropical downtown Green Bay, here at City Deck Landing, broadcasting statewide from our WGBW studios. Always so much fun here, and love your texts. Keep them coming. My next guest, here's what I'm trying to do, folks. When I first launched the show, I kind of put the word out. I want people from all over the state, because we broadcast statewide. I want to know what's going on in your community. I want to know who's from there, what people of note. What do you have? Famous movie stars, athletes, train robbers. I want to know who is from your town. I would love it if people from around the state would share that with me from time to time, as I did when I first launched the show and talked about my hometown, my adopted hometown of Marinette, Wisconsin. So feel free to do that, and I am trying to find out what's going on in the state, too. Since we broadcast from City Deck Landing here in Green Bay, it's a little easier for me to find people very entrenched in the community. And I found just such a person, and she's pretty cool. She is the Business Development Director of the Children's Museum in Green Bay, Heather Heil. Heather,
hi,
welcome.
How are you? I almost said good morning. I'm drinking coffee this late at night, so yeah, I hope I'm peppy enough for you.
You just got up a few minutes ago. That's fine. We can treat this like morning radio.
Okay.
If you so choose.
Sounds good.
You have one of those names. I said Heather Heil High. I should have just said Heather Heil.
Yeah, you could have.
I could have. Mm-hmm. I have Schwabba. It's a weird one. Like Peach Schwabba. Everyone thinks I'm saying Peach. And there was a girl at where I went to school in college, and she thought my name was Peach Cobbler.
Really? For how
like
long
a month
did this go on?
She was a fellow RA.
Okay.
And she looked at me. She said, "What's your name?" And I said, "Pete Schwabba." And she goes, "Dang, I thought your name was Peach Cobbler."
Yes.
I'm like, no. And then a comedian, another comedian in Chicago, a guy who's much older, who I looked up to, made fun of my name every night when I worked with him. And he said, Peach Guava. That's my favorite flavor of dessert.
So I love it. Right on there.
It's I've been having, it's been a tough life.
No, it hasn't. You. We were talking, you were a comedian. That is fascinating to me.
Really?
At 100%. How does one just, I'm going to go do stand-up. How terrifying.
Well, here's how it happens, Heather. Let me spell this out for you.
Here we go. Yep, I'm slow.
I was a dunce. I was a solid C student, and I didn't know what else to do. So stand-up comedy, that was my fallback.
Class clown. Yeah?
I don't know. Class clown is like usually a cry for help.
Okay.
I wasn't that guy.
No.
But I would say things I probably shouldn't have from time to time. Sometimes they get laughs, and sometimes I'd get a beating.
Not so much. So. Who's your favorite comedian? I know. I put you on the spot there.
You know what? Right now, I would say one of my favorites is Brian Regan.
Okay.
Who's been around a while and who's great. He works totally clean. He's very funny. That's not why I like him. He's just funny. And another guy from Chicago called Pat McGann. And another friend of mine called Mike Toomey, who's also from Chicago.
Excellent.
That's where I started.
Yeah,
so
sure.
Fun. Yeah. What about you? What are your favorite comedians?
Oh, you know what? As wrong as it, like, I just watched the Chappelle special.
Why is that wrong?
Is.
You feel like you shouldn't laugh?
I shouldn't be laughing at the things that he's saying, and it shouldn't be read. Like some of it, I was like, okay, maybe not for me. But some of it's like just so real and authentic, and I do resonate with people that are just themselves and talk about where they come from and how they got there, and it's relatable.
Yeah, he can be very brilliant.
Yes.
But I agree. There's times where I'm like, you didn't have to say that.
Right.
But whatever. It's not my.
That wasn't necessary.
You know,
right.
Yeah.
Which makes
sense. He's a very shy guy too. I would see him around L.A. when I lived there, and he was just a very. He's not the class clown, as you would say.
Wow.
Like, he's not.
No.
He's just a very reserved dude and very thoughtful.
That surprises me. Well, interesting.
Yeah. So now you asked me that question to throw it back at you. Who are your favorite business development directors of children's museums?
That would be me. No,
you're
I'm
your
just
own
kidding.
Favorite.
No,
you're your
I'm
own
not.
Best friend.
I'm my own cheerleader. No, of course not. No, I really just enjoy the job that I'm doing here in our community.
Tell us
to
about
be
it.
Able,
tell us about the Green Bay Children's Museum. When my kids were young, we made a point to go to as many children's museums as we could. They're so fun, and I love the energy of them, if you can stomach the parents, they're very fun. So
it is. It's all about the kiddos there at the museum. So we know in our research, as far as we are, Pete, that the 90% of a child's development is 0 to 5 years old. So if you are thinking you're going to put them in pre-K and K and they're going to be ready to go, you are sorely mistaken. We need to get them from birth moving on and educate them in a really fun way. We also know that 1 in 3 children do not read at a proficient level when they are entering kindergarten right now. So we need to take that very seriously and continue to serve those children and families in our community.
Yeah, absolutely. My wife teaches kindergarten. And
I
can relate to what you're saying. So and especially the way they learn at children's museums, how they're stimulated and the fun ways they get to develop their brain. We've been to so many children's museums, but you know what? We never lived in Green Bay, so we've never been to the one here. What's the first thing you would say about it? If you had a family coming in, where would you steer them?
Going into the museum, well, they're going to come in and it's going to start right away. When they walk in, there is a ginormous mouth that they are going to be able to climb in to help them learn about digestion and how we eat and what goes in must come out.
Yeah.
So they're actually, you know, doing the digestive tract and crawling through and learning those components. It's all fun and all children are different. Your child is special and they grip onto certain things that others don't. So they might really be into the arts and crafts, and we have an arts and crafts room. They might really be into water play. We have the water play. They might be into building things. They might be into climbing.
Yeah.
Whatever that is, they are all learning. And there are common core and criteria in our museum that we are meeting to make sure that they are on the development track that they need to be on.
That is so great. I see a lot of kids go right for the snack bar or right for the concessions. Yeah. So it's nice that you have digestion. Can they crawl like in? I remember there was a children's museum we went to somewhere and a kid could crawl into the large intestine or something like that.
Yes, exactly the same. Right in.
Yep,
and it's
nuts.
Like a big slide and it's a lot of
fun. You know
what
you should do?
Yeah.
You should put like a tapeworm in there and have him sort of try to
Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Like there, this is what happens.
You got to earn this, kid.
Yeah.
Come out of here.
Traumatize them with that. No.
And you're very involved in the community here
in
Green Bay.
Mm-hmm.
And Kristen Lyerly introduced us.
She's also my most favorite human.
Yeah, you guys are like, own this town. So tell me, because my show is on statewide, tell me, if you were talking to someone from La Crosse mm-hmm. or Baraboo or mm-hmm. wherever, Ashland, who had never been to Green Bay, and they are out there, mm-hmm. what would you say about Green Bay? Why Green Bay?
It is the kindest town ever. Everyone will say hello to you. It is 1 degree of Green Bay. Everybody knows somebody through 1 degree. Everyone is willing to help with anything. I came in here tonight and was talking to some of the staff here and about other things. And, hey, how can I help you to do this? How can you? It's just everyone wants to help everyone to get to their next goal in life and in this community.
That's a great town motto, actually, is mm-hmm. how can I help?
How can I help you?
Why don't people? I think more people should ask me for advice. Can you,
they should. This is fantastic.
Right, I'm an idea guy. You know?
You are. I love this.
as Larry David said in Curb Your Enthusiasm, I'm not an inventor. I'm an improver.
So. Yes, Larry David.
So, okay. So the people are kind. What else does Green Bay have to offer? I'm Joe Schmo in Ashland. That's a real guy.
Mm-hmm.
What else would you tell them?
Well, I would first and foremost, there is a lot to do. There are people that live here who I find that there's like, oh, there's nothing to do here. The adult syndrome of I'm bored. Well, you know what? Open your eyes because it is happening in our community. There is theater. There is live music. And Pete, I will stand on a mountaintop and shout this for the rest of my life. Support live local music or it will die. It is so important to get out there and support those musicians doing what they're doing in any way that you can. So make a date night, like make time for your girlfriends. We were talking earlier as well. I'm in a million clubs with different groups of friends just so I can connect with them. But it's also supporting other things in our community.
We will talk about all the clubs that you're involved in because you told me
it's pretty overwhelming, by the way.
It's unsettling, to be honest. So you're saying I should take my girlfriend out to see live music and my wife, or should not?
Both.
Not, okay.
Not together.
Fair enough.
Mm-hmm.
That's equal opportunity. Okay, so is Green Bay a good music scene? Are there good bands here?
Absolutely.
I've had a few of them in the studio here, and it's been so much fun. Yeah, I've had 7,000 Apart.
Okay.
Well, I've had them in twice. They were so good. I've had Frank Herman's in, who's
Frank
outstanding.
Is, yeah, their dinner theater is awesome. They're actually launching a new dinner theater here at the Meyer Theater. 2.5 Belgians, I think, is coming up. And it's a fantastic show.
I think that's going to really help Frank to get himself out there a little bit in the community. He needs to have more of a presence.
I wish he would come out of his shell. Yeah.
He's great. He was in here. He sang. I've had a couple opera singers in here. I had the Doctors in Recital, which is a really fun band.
Yes, I'm going to that this weekend. And there are tickets that are still available. It is Saturday evening at the Widener Center at 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock. Mm-hmm. If you need tickets, I'll be out there scalping. I bought them dirt cheap.
You did perfect.
I'm going to unload them.
Mine were free from Kristen, so mine are even cheaper too.
What is the deal? I wish I was that. That's so cool. What about theater? So is there a lot of live theater here that's great?
There really is. So we have the Green Bay Community Theater, which is, I always enjoy because it is local celebrities, for lack of a better word. Yeah. So you'll see like the local news anchor in a production or your friend. And again, how can we help you? That little small town and a big town hospitality. There's also the Birder Theater. That's just a hop, skip, and a jump in the De Pere area. There is the Meyer Theater. I will tell you, beautiful theater. And they bring in some of the best acts as far as like tribute bands. And they're bringing in a Led Zeppelin tribute band coming up called Get the Let Out. Unbelievable. We're seeing Project Pink, which is a Pink Floyd tribute band. Again, look for this stuff, people. It is out there.
What about like local? My guest, by the way, is Heather Heil. I'm just coining the phrase right. She is Miss Green Bay. She knows everything about this community here that we broadcast our show from. Well, you better start learning because you have the title now.
Yes. Okay.
She's joining me here, helping me close down tonight's show, which has been so much fun. Are there a lot? Yeah, local musicians can this be a springboard for people? Are there enough venues in town?
Absolutely, there are. And I actually would be more comfortable, if you're okay with it, sharing some of the venues to go see these duos that are acoustic and just trying out. So there is a place called L'Vive in De Pere that is wonderful for live local music. Ledgestone Vineyards also has a ton of series. They have a cellar series in the winter. Outdoors. You can find this at the Epic Event Center has music in the Mez on Wednesday nights. And I don't know the schedule about the Wednesdays that they're on, where they'll bring in those local musicians that you're able to see. Go to a farmer's market, indoor and outdoors, and those musicians are there. Support your local breweries, and they have musicians there. You don't always have to be drinking when you're doing these things. They're everywhere.
Well, we are in Wisconsin.
We kind of do, yeah.
And by the end of the night, you'll be singing on a corner yourself.
Give me some wine and cheese. Woo! Yeah.
Well, that's really good to know. So you told me too about an Instagram page you started, and it's in its infancy, but I think that's a great idea. Tell us about your Instagram page you just started.
Thank you for asking that, Pete. So
You're welcome.
Really have been processing the NFL draft and people coming to our community. And when I go to other communities, I want to know what the locals do. I don't want to go to a chain restaurant. I love them dearly, but when I'm going to visit, I want to know what the local flair is doing. So I created an Instagram page called Green Bay and Beyond. So when I'm traveling and doing stuff, I can just do some photos and do little reels with that stuff to share kind of my experiences. And hopefully other people will be able to find these fun experiences.
That's so cool. So what's the page? Is it just called?
It's called Green Bay and Beyond on Instagram. Yep. Not on Facebook, just Instagram.
And wow, that's really cool. So we should talk about the draft too, because everyone is talking about, like, are there enough hotel rooms? Where will this event happen? Where will this event happen? But you said something I thought was really interesting. You said, where should we tell people to go? You don't want them to go to said franchise chain.
No.
They're
going
to go there anyway.
Yeah.
You're right. Some of those places are great. But where do they really get a taste of Green Bay? Mm-hmm. What will leave a mark with them when they leave? I had the best cheeseburger I've ever had or a brat or whatever, you know?
Yep, exactly.
How do you do that? How do you get that word out?
That's what I'm trying to figure out, Pete. That's what I want to do. So, I want to get the message out to the people.
So go to her Instagram page one more time.
Green Bay and Beyond.
Green Bay and Beyond, and leave suggestions, right?
Yeah.
I mean, start following it and we'll take it from there. I think that's a great start. So, okay. When we come back, I'm going to ask you what you're watching, and I'm going to ask you about all the clubs you're in.
Okay.
You're not in the He-Man Woman Haters Club, are
you?
Yes,
I do have one for that, too.
Rascals?
Oh, I sure am.
Do you? Mm-hmm. Oh, you cover all your bases.
Darla.
Okay.
Yep.
We're spending the last part of the show tonight on Nightlight with Heather Heil. She is Miss Green Bay, newly titled.
Oh, boy.
No pressure.
It is.
And
a lot.
This is Nightlight with Peach Wabba on the Civic Media Radio Network.
Light so bright. Did we get hit last night? Like Elvis, why am I wearing your class ring? Don't call your mother, 'cause no one partners in crime. Don't be a baby, remember what you told me.
Welcome back. This is Nightlight.
Hello.
Broadcasting statewide from the City Deck Landing Studios here in Green Bay. My guest helping me close out the show tonight is Miss Green Bay, the newly titled Miss Green Bay.
We're going to work on that title.
And she will
FYI.
Be known around this studio from here on out.
Okay, great.
So that gives you... You can use it on a resume because it is real, but it's only here.
My gosh.
So if you leave the studio and you just want to be Heather, that's fine.
Okay, perfect.
All right. So Heather is the business development director of the Children's Museum here in Green Bay. And she's also very tied into the community, very, very involved. And we spoke a little bit before the break about all the clubs you're in.
Yes.
Can you please elaborate?
Yes. So I am a very busy gal, as most of you are busy out there. And part of my connection with my different groups of friends is I know that we have common interests. So I have friends that I go see live music with and friends that like movies and different things. So I have created little clubs with them that we are dedicating the time to each other once a month or every other month to go do those things. So there's a documentary club. There is a movie club. There is a wine club. There is a book club. There is a cheese club. There is, So
That's
I get
crazy.
Together with these ladies and do these things. And it's things that we like to do and we make time for. We've talked about how both you and I love to read books, and we just, as adults, don't make time to do that. We don't prioritize that. So how can we make it a win-win where we're reading the books and getting together with those people that you find yourself saying, hey, we should get together sometime.
Yeah.
2 years later, no.
How do you, I first of all, I used to be a reader. I admit mm-hmm. I am not. I was an English major in college. I'm not as much of a reader now as I wish I was. I've tried to start again, but my attention span is gone. I admit mm-hmm. it. From
Fair.
Phones, TV, computers. Yep. Sometimes I've got all three of them going at once.
Yep.
I know that's not healthy. I tell my kids that's not healthy. But I have recently started trying to read more, and doing this show has helped me because I'm trying to have authors on and I want to read their books before mm-hmm. they come on the show. But how do you don't read with people at the club. Like you guys don't get together and read, do you?
No, we do it on the, for the reading and the documentary, we do it separately and then we come together and discuss the book.
We can watch documentaries together.
We could, but we don't. So we just then come together and it's, again, it's a lot of being social, but it then also being able to see these things. And like, can I just tell you about the last documentary we watched?
Yeah,
it was so fantastic. It was called Crip Camp. Have you heard of this documentary?
I have not, no.
I believe it's on Netflix, and it is the production company that Barack and Michelle Obama started. And it is about a camp from, I believe, in the early 80s, 70s, where it's not PC to say this anymore, but when they had disabled people would go to these camps.
Oh, camp, like crippled, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And just talking about the affirmative action and how they found a home at this camp and how they found their voices and were able to go and legislate and do all of these things with President Reagan. And it was so profound to me of that. I mean, that was 30 years ago.
Time ago. Yeah.
Yeah. That this was happening in our country. And I just found that fascinating. So it's, again, just watching stuff I wouldn't think I would be watching by having this club too. So, and learning.
That's fun. I kind of feel like this show in effect is like a movie or TV club. Mm-hmm. That's what we do here. We just talk about TV and movies. But do you ever, like when you get together, does it ever turn into like a Donnybrook or a brawl? No, people just disagree.
There are
really?
Some of
heated?
In my book club, it gets very heated because it is a very diverse group of women who feel very strongly about things. And especially when you're reading books that maybe some trigger things are in, and it's just very fascinating to learn more about them, of why they hated a character or the development, or there hasn't been any lost friendships or anything, but some strong words, strong language. I'm going to send you a strongly worded letter.
You never know what's going to set someone off. What are their clubs? Is there anything like different that we might not have heard of? Like, equestrian club?
There's no horses. There's no, I'm just like looking here, the live music, doing that, the wine. I have a little coffee clutch that I'll grab some coffee with sometimes.
What is a coffee clutch? What does that mean? What's the word clutch?
A clutch is
kind
like
of a word guy.
Yeah.
And I don't understand how clutch works into that at all.
Clutch is a bunch of people coming together, just a clutch of people. Is that a Wisconsin word?
I don't know. It doesn't make any sense to me, but do I know?
A coffee clutch. So getting together. And there, we actually just purchased, Venture Wisconsin has a passport for coffee places in the state. So we are going to start navigating off of that for our coffee clutch to go and have some coffee.
But mostly it's just to be social.
It's just to be social.
Excuse to get together and have community and all that kind of stuff, which is pretty cool.
100%. And, and again, I also had found that a lot of my girlfriends were like, we're single and, we never have anybody to do anything with and there's never anything to do. It's there. Find the friends, find the interest. They're there.
I got a new one for you.
Yes, please. Oh, boy.
Nap club. Let's all get together and take a nap.
In.
Yeah.
I am in.
It doesn't have to be weird, but we're all going to sleep.
Like, just sleep.
Yeah, and then
just
we'll get up and discuss
time.
It. Yeah.
I love this idea.
Okay.
So would you dream
no
about...
No snoring, though. You can't...
Well, I can't control that.
Yeah. What did you dream about? That'll be a way to rub people the wrong way. Okay, so what we do on this show, Heather, too, is we talk about movies and TV. What are you watching? What can you recommend?
Right now, I have started binge-watching Miss Maisel, The Marvelous Miss Maisel.
Great show.
I love that period piece. It's so fantastic, and it's
and
a
Rachel
comedian.
Rachel Brosnahan is from... born in Milwaukee.
She was. And Monk. Is from Green Bay.
DePere?
So
I think DePere.
He's from DePere. Yeah. His great grandma was a Saruji. So there's a Saruji connection there.
Really?
There is. You're looking at me surprised.
Heir to the Saruji fortune?
He might be.
Wow. I'll have to have him on the show. See if he can flip me.
He was just here.
I know. He was here at the Packer game, I remember, with Taylor Swift was there and Simone Biles.
I happened to be lucky enough. I was on the sidelines, and all of a sudden I like look over, and there I'm like, there's Peter Shalhoub. Like, what's happening?
Tony.
Tony Shalhoub. Peter, what? I didn't even know. Yeah. I'm
you
like,
probably,
hey, Hey,
it's probably his
you?
Brother who would appreciate being recognized.
Tony, sorry. Yeah.
Anything else you're watching? Oscar films?
And the movie club, we will typically go to the theaters to see all of them and then watch the Oscars together to cheer it on. So we know what they're talking about. We haven't been diligent with that, but I have seen Barbie and Oppenheimer, and I love them both for very different reasons.
Very different films, but in their own right. And do you think Greta Gerwig got snubbed?
Absolutely.
I do too. Yeah. That's crazy.
It was a fantastic performance.
Yeah, it was fun. Well, hey, you got to come back and do this again sometime. You are Miss Green Bay, so you owe it to us to fill us in and give you my knowledge
of what to do. Where do the locals go?
Thanks so much, Heather.
Thank you so much, Pete.
All right. Thank you to Heather. Thank you to Mike Clemens and Tim Sauers. All your texts. Great as always. Great dialogue. Great discussion tonight. And we will see you back here tomorrow night where Madison, Capital Times reporter, entertainment reporter Rob Thomas will join me. And we will talk more Oscars and more snubs. It's fun to talk about the snubs. Thanks so much for being with me tonight. We'll see you tomorrow for more Nightlight here in the Civic Media Radio Network. Good night, Wisconsin. Sing it to